Hi, my name is Nikhilesh.
And my name is Kushal. And today we have an interesting question for you. Why does a fluid follow the contour of a body?
So what do we mean by following the contour of a body? If you consider the classical example of a flow around an airfoil, you see that the flow tends to take the shape of the airfoil. So our question is, why does the flow behave in this way?
Intuitively, you would expect particles to collide with each other and bounce off. What we mean is that if you throw a ball on the floor, you expect it to bounce back. Now consider a couple of fluid particles bouncing off the surface of a cylinder. What you observe is something similar to what you see when billiard balls strike each other. Incidentally, on an interesting side note is that Sir Isaac Newton also considered a similar hypothesis for fluid flow. However, he considered that the fluid particles lost their momentum after striking the body.
Now consider the same example, but see what happens in a realistic fluid flow. So if you observe, the particles seem to follow the contour of the sphere. Although you might be kind of preconditioned to accept this because of the videos or the images you have seen, it is quite counterintuitive to what Kushal has just explained, that the particles hit the surface and bounce off. So this brings us to the fundamental difference in the way we view fluid flow as opposed to simply particles colliding with each other and the surface. So this is a concept that we feel should be emphasized when taking introductory fluid mechanics courses. And the concept that we're talking about is continuum mechanics. You would have heard of the concept of fluid being a continuum, meaning that we model the fluid as a continuous mass instead of discrete particles. So our question today, and something that we're trying to answer today, is how does modeling the fluid as a continuum affect the behavior of the flow?
When you model the fluid as a continuum, you have to keep in mind that the atoms or particles of the fluid do not act independently anymore, as in the case of classical mechanics, like shown in the problem with the billiard balls. When the fluid now interacts with the body, it is also simultaneously interacting with other fluid particles around it. So when the fluid particles near the surface of the cylinder are being pushed upwards, you see that it is also experiencing a force from the particles above it, which is this fluid then exerts the force, which is we then quantify as pressure.
So let's consider the flow around an airfoil again, and this time let's look at the pressure contours around the airfoil. If you observe closely in the far field, or in other words, at a point which is very far away from the airfoil, you see that the flow exerts a higher pressure than at a point which is closer to the airfoil. And this higher pressure is what causes the flow near the airfoil to deflect towards the airfoil, or rather follow the contour of the airfoil. After Newton first hypothesized his particles impinging on the surface theory, Leonard Euler later pointed out the physical inconsistencies in his model. So if you look at the animation of the particles impinging on the surface and bouncing off again, you see that it is quite different from the actual fluid flow, where the particles start changing their course even before impinging on the surface of the cylinder.
This is another consequence of modeling the fluid as a continuum. The basic idea is that the fluid propagates information backwards. Since you already consider the fluid as a field of particles, the particles approaching the cylinder is already receiving information from the particles ahead of it, because of which it starts adjusting its course.
So now hopefully we have explained the difference between modeling a fluid as a continuum as opposed to a set of discrete particles. We would like to leave you with a couple of questions, a couple of thought experiments, if you mind. If you observe the video of the fluid going past the cylinder, you see that even though the different particles start at the same time, they seem to move with different velocities, and they don't seem to move at the same time together. So this seems quite counterintuitive. And our question to you is, can you come up with a reason why this happens?
Another important question is knowing when we can apply continuum mechanics and in what cases we cannot apply it. Now let us consider a case where the number of particles are reduced, like for the example in vacuum. Will continuum mechanics still be applicable, and where does the limit lie?
So all the videos and the pictures that we have showed you up till now were considering a special branch of fluid mechanics called potential flow, where we do not consider the viscous effects of fluids. When you add viscous effects, you go into separate phenomena like flow separation and other viscous related effects.
So stay tuned for future videos.
Like the fluid flow we just showed you, please stay attached to our channel for more interesting videos.
And if you have any ideas for future videos or answers to these questions, please leave a comment in the comment box below. And don't forget to like, share and subscribe. See you soon. Bye!